Welcome, friends, to our first webinar of 2023, Gay Priest John McNeill, Stories of a Passionate and Prophetic Witness, presented by filmmaker Brendan Fay and theologian Mary E. Hunt. I am Mark Bowman, Executive Director of the LGBTQ Religious Archives Network, the host of tonight's program. LGBTQ RAN is a unique venture dedicated to preserving the history of LGBTQ religious movements around the world. LGBTQ RAN is a digital enterprise. We are not a physical repository that stores papers. We advise and support leaders and groups in their efforts to preserve their records in appropriate archives. Furthermore, we collect and provide a treasure of historical information on our website about LGBTQ plus persons and groups from a wide array of religious expressions around the world. And finally, we encourage research and scholarship in queer religious history. Tonight, we are pleased to have the opportunity to explore the life of one of the iconic figures of LGBTQ religious movements the past 50 years, Father John McNeill. Born in 1925, McNeill was an Irish-American priest from Buffalo, New York, a pioneer of LGBTQ liberation, particularly in Catholicism. McNeill co-founded Dignity New York in 1972, and in 1976, published the groundbreaking book, The Church and the Homosexual. In 1977 and in 83, McNeill was ordered to be silent by church leaders for speaking and writing on issues of homosexuality. However, McNeill unflinchingly continued his pastoral and prophetic ministry and witness. Tonight, you will see and hear a multimedia presentation about McNeill's life and ministry, narrated by filmmaker Brendan Fay. Brendan is an Irish-American human rights activist and filmmaker. He has been active on campaigns for immigration reform, civil marriage, HIV/AIDS awareness, inclusive parades, cultural hospitality, policing reform, human rights, and nuclear disarmament. Brendan's deep admiration for John McNeill led him to profile John's life in the 2012 documentary film, Taking a Chance on God. More recently, Fay has produced a 2021 documentary, Remembering Michael, about the New York City Fire Department chaplain who tragically died on September 11th, 2001. Following Brendan's presentation, you will hear some reflections on McNeill's life from Mary E. Hunt, PhD, a feminist theologian who is co-founder and co-director of the Women's Alliance for Theology, Ethics, and Ritual, WATER, in Silver Spring, Maryland. A Catholic active in the women church movement, Hunt lectures and writes on theology and ethics with particular attention to social justice concerns. To those of you watching this webinar, and this is actually the largest attendance we've had for one of our programs, thank you all for being here. We do welcome your comments or questions in the chat box of the Q&A function. The presenters will respond to those during the Q&A time for the end of tonight's program. And if you would like to offer personal greetings or comments to one of the presenters, stay after the webinar is concluded and you will be invited into the Zoom room with them. Please direct any technical concerns to Asati, who is the tech manager for this program. Now, I am pleased to welcome Brendan Fay, to present Gay Priest John McNeill, Stories of a Passionate and Prophetic Witness.
Hello, good evening, and thank you, Mark, for that beautiful welcome. Thank you to the LGBTQ Religious Archives Network for hosting this gathering. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Mary Hunt. Thank you, Asadi and Jesus, for helping bring us all together. And I thank each and everyone that is participating in this roundtable, this virtual roundtable of storytelling and remembering of John McNeill, priest, theologian, healer, therapist. And we also celebrate the witness of his life, of love, and the prophetic witness of John as a voice of liberation for the LGBTQ movement. How beautiful it is to be gathering in January. This was always an important time in John's life. Around this time each January, John would wake his way to Kirkridge, Pennsylvania, to lead a retreat for gay men. He also would lead one every June, but January was so important for him. Also, it was in January that John received permission from his superiors to publish the work that is his work on gay liberation, the church, and the homosexual. John McNeill is a boy from Buffalo, upstate New York, born on September 2nd, 1925, to Charles and Mary McNeill. Irish they were. His mother Mary actually came from the west of Ireland. His father Charles, his people were originally from the north of Ireland. He worked actually on the Erie Barge Canal. Sad moment in his childhood was when his mother Mary died on December 23, 1929, when John was just four. But his Aunt Katie, Mary's sister, who was also from Ireland, helping out at the house, married his father, Charlie, and helped raise the children to keep them together. There were four boys and one girl. At 10, John was a newsboy in Buffalo delivering the evening news, and John became an altar boy at the Church of St. Nicholas. In 1938, John begins high school at St. Joseph's. And in January 1942, John begins a first year at the Jesuit Canisius College. This is also the time of World War II, and things move along. And in the end, John enlists in the army at the age of 17. His older brothers were already in the army and overseas. While he was being trained, John actually meets Samuel Menashe, young Jewish poet, writer. They were all but teenagers, but it begins a lifelong friendship between these two that would go right into their 80s. In December 1944, John is captured by the Germans. In September, they'd set out and landed in France as part of D-Day invasion. And John was captured. He ended up being a prisoner of war for 6 months, being moved all around. In fact, he speaks about being on the train, and literally surviving, being locked for 10 days in the freight car, and surviving by licking off the frosted nails. While a prisoner of war, he was assigned to work on a farm. And there he was inspired by the kindness of a Polish slave laborer who was mixing mash to feed the animals, who seeing John picked a potato and threw it to him. John was so moved by this, he actually just expressed a thanks to the Polish slave laborer who responded by making the sign of the cross. John never forgot this moment of faith, of courage, of kindness in the midst of the evil of the prison camp. On May 2nd, 1945, John and other prisoners were finally liberated from the prison camp. And John, in November 9, 1945, was discharged from the US Army. From 1945 to 1948, John was back at Canisius College. He put himself totally into the studies. He joined the debate team, the glee club, and actually graduated with honors. At the end, he considered whether he would become a doctor, a lawyer, but in the end, he said that God was nudging, pulling at his heart. And in August 1948, John entered the Jesuit novitiate. And he said it awakened in him a deep love, like Saint Ignatius, to become a companion of Jesus. He threw himself totally into the studies of philosophy and theology. And it was there he was first introduced to the ideas of the French philosopher, theologian, Maurice Blondel, whose key idea was that action has a power to bring a knowing that is beyond intellect. Of course, we're all familiar with I think, therefore I am. Maurice Blondel was suggesting, in fact, there is another way of knowing, the way we live, the way we experience, the way we act. And he would always say, anyone who knows love knows God. John was ordained in June 1959 at Fordham University. And here is a picture you can see with his family and friends. And in the back row is his dear friend from the military days, Samuel Menashe. In 1960, John moves to the Jesuit community at Rue de Grenelle in Paris. He's very influenced by the French worker priest movement. And also he begins working with young people in the poorer sections of Paris. He studies Maurice Blondel, which eventually becomes the subject of his dissertation. And that was all about the theme being love in action and human experience is primary. Indeed, for Blondel, a primary gospel text was he or she who does the truth comes to the light. In 1964, John graduates from the University of Louvain with his doctorate. But John also reflects on this time as a time of struggle with his own experience of being gay and Catholic. He talks about nights of depression along the Seine River. And indeed, he acknowledges there were times he considered suicide. He seeks out help. And in fact, he is sent for medical injections. He is told to try more penance and more prayer. But later also, while visiting the south of France, John meets Tony Ginesco and has his first experience of gay love and intimacy. Back in New York, after studying in Europe, John begins teaching ethics at Fordham University and at Le Moyne College, where he spends 5 years. This is the time of the Vietnam War, and students are organizing on campuses across the nation, including at Le Moyne College. Given John's experience of the trauma, the terror, and the memories of war, he totally supports the organizing of conscientious objectors on the campus. And he actually coordinates and works with his fellow Jesuit, Father Dan Berrigan. Their shared life becomes a sharing of friendship and peace activism around Syracuse area. John wrote many times that hatred of enemy is contrary to Christian values. And he speaks at anti-war rallies in the Syracuse area. Many of the religious leaders were actually not happy with this outspoken Jesuit speaking about his own experience of war. In fact, one of the major ones was following his 1969 anti-war address at the Unitarian Church in Utica. John is removed by the local police for disturbing the peace and told not to return to Utica. He joins conscientious objectors who are making their way seeking refuge in Canada. While in visiting Toronto, John visits a gay bar called the St. Charles Bar. And on January 1, 1965, John meets Charlie, who would become the love of his life. And with Charlie, this becomes a profound witness of love and mutual care for one another. In John and with John, it became a seeking to live life more honestly and more authentically. It was a journey of soul searching, a journey of coming out. John was profoundly moved by the warm embrace and acceptance of Charlie's family. And thus begins a journey of 4 decades of love and life with Charlie, which are transformational for John. Here are a few images of John and Charlie over the years. Back in New York, just after Stonewall, John is immediately organizing and thinking. He reads an article in the Homiletical and Pastoral Review that reinforces the notion, the idea, that homosexuality is a sickness. So John feels compelled to respond. As he says, given his own experience of gay love, he cannot be silent. And so in 1970, writes a series of articles on homosexuality for the Homiletical and Pastoral Review. And in 1972, John speaks to the New York Jesuit community on gay liberation, bringing representatives of the different groups as well who speak with him. And then John, along with his Jesuit confrere, Robert Carter, they begin Dignity New York, the LGBT group for Catholics. John would say, dignity is not something we can give ourselves, but something we give each other. And in fact, John would often talk about the importance of forming communities of solidarity and friendship. And of course, a movement began to grow, and at its peak, over 300 were meeting weekly for mass and for conversation and for outreach. The Woodstock Jesuits, of which John was his community, welcomed Dignity New York for 2 years, from 72 to 74.
So this is a little documentary, and we're going to be covering the early period.
Okay. Well,
but what we'd love is somebody.
Well, I was just reminiscing about the very first organizational meeting that John called at 220 West 98th Street on July 10th, 1972. And it was in the Jesuit chapel on the ground floor, and there were about 15 or 20 people there. And I wasn't living in that building at the time, but I remember walking to the meeting and being filled with anxiety, wondering what I was getting myself into. And then within 20 minutes, as people went around talking about while they were there, I felt very much at ease and knew this was where I belonged.
Yeah, that was, I sent out a letter to everyone I thought would be interested. Peter Fink, another Jesuit, was there. And was maybe 10 other people, most of whom I think are dead. And we discussed the possibility of establishing a New York City chapter of Dignity, and discussed what role we'd play and what purpose we would have and how we go about it. And we were really winging it, you know. We had no press and nothing. I remember I went to one of the bishops of New York City and said, asked him, what ministry do you have for gay and lesbians? And he turned scarlet and he said to me, what do you mean, what ministry? All our churches meet their needs adequately. We have no need of any special ministry.
Right.
So, and you know, I remember saying, well, I'm not going to get any help from this corner, you know, in establishing this. In fact, probably opposition
right.
has proved to be true.
So after 30 years, what does tonight feel, coming in and meeting Bob, and how does it feel for both of you?
Enormous joy on my part. Just a real feeling that the Holy Spirit has been with us for 30 years and has done so much healing, sanctifying, and encouraging for the gay and lesbian community, and not just those who meet here. It goes way beyond the doors of this building, and literally hundreds of thousands of people have been liberated by the fact that the Spirit called us together and blessed our effort to bring the message of God's love to gay and lesbian people.
Right. Bob, what do you think coming back?
Oh, it's great coming back, and I don't get here very often. I get to Dignity, Philadelphia a couple times a year, and it's very interesting just seeing how Dignity functions in different cities and different places. And they have a very active, vibrant chapter down there. And it's good to see that, you know, Dignity is not limited just to New York. We in New York tend to think that the world ends at the Hudson River, but
that's right, Bob.
It's good to see that.
Here's the last question, Bob. Bob, when you look at John and hear him tonight, and a brother, a fellow community member, you know, how do you feel about John's journey? Any thoughts on John and his journey and his ministry?
I admire John's journey immensely. John had an awful decision to make as to whether to remain a Jesuit and keep quiet or to speak out prophetically and under the inspiration of the Spirit, and he chose that, which I think was the right decision for him, and I admire it a great deal. I had to make a similar decision, and I decided the other way for different reasons, but I admire John's decision. It took great courage and great love.
Thank you.
John was encouraged by fellow faculty at the Woodstock Seminary and to take the articles that he'd published in the Homiletic and Pastoral Review and use them as a basis for a book on the issue of the church and the homosexual. But there was also pressure growing on Father Pedro Arupe, the Jesuit general in Rome, from church hierarchy regarding John's teachings. In fact, articles were appearing where there was discussions of, is John McNeill promoting equal blessing and affirmation of the love between members of the same sex and marriage? But anyway, in the end, John's manuscript, which was already finished in 73, was subject to a rare scrutiny and review by a number of Jesuit scholars here in the United States, and then also another group in Rome. But on January 28, 1976, finally the letter came from the provincial. I am happy to grant imprimi potest, the permission to publish as of this day. It was a major moment for the LGBT community. And then invitations came from everywhere. John and his book ended up on the front page of the New York Times. The book was translated into many languages. He began to get invited on national television. As Robert McCleary in his thesis says, basically what John had hoped was to move the discussion forward within the church and within society. John's message and ministry was one of liberation and healing. John's message was, gay love is a holy love. And then in November 1976, on the Today Show, John McNeill, discussing his book, is asked if he himself is gay. And he becomes the first Catholic priest to come out on national television on the Today Show. before millions of viewers. Then The Church and the Homosexual becomes a bestseller. It rocks the church. It's translated into multiple languages, including Spanish, French, Italian, and Danish. On the book, at the Oscar Wilde Memorial Bookshop, the owner, Craig Rodwell, himself a gay pioneer, wrote a letter to John that I'd like to read just one or two sentences. Dear John McNeill, I am writing to inquire about the paperback status of your book, The Church and the Homosexuals. We have sold over 600 copies of the hardcover edition and over 1,000 of the paperback edition. And then he closes the letter by saying, please let me add on a personal note that I know your book has brought healing to many thousands of lesbian and gay Catholics, healing of the false sense of guilt in being gay. It is very important that this book sees even more the light of print again. Kindest regards, Craig Rodwell. In 1977, basically John's book and his coming out has such a profound impact around the world. But because he was asking for reform of Catholic teaching on homosexuality, John is silenced by Vatican officials, forbidden to write or speak on homosexuality. The Congregation for Doctrine and Faith, in fact, directs the Jesuit General, Father Pedro Rupe, to remove the Imprimi Potest on further editions and to order John's silence. John agrees to silence because he anticipates eventual acceptance. In a way, it's John's sense of surrender and trust in the church. He really thought it would be a short time. His friend, Father Dan Berrigan, prepares a letter in support of John, which is then co-signed by 18 of his New York Jesuit members of the community. Silenced, John decides, as he's counseling LGBT people at this time, that he needs more professional training. And at the age of 50 in 1975, John trains at the Blanton Peel Institute as a psychotherapist and a spiritual director. But as part of this, he undergoes his own intense therapeutic process. Again, this self-reflection of John on where he's coming from and his journey. Eventually, he's actually invited to become a teacher at the Institute, and he opens up his own therapy practice in New York City. John provides spiritual direction for so many, including fellow priests, and among them, Father Dan McCarthy and Father Michael George Franciscan. Eventually then, in the 80s, while John is maintaining his silence, in August 1985, John is presenting a reflection on freedom and conscience for the Dignity Convention in New York City. And that November, Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, now prefect of the Congregation for Doctrine and Faith, orders John to withdraw from all ministry to homosexual persons. John responds in very typical John McNeill way. He takes time away to pray and reflect at the Trappist monastery at Gethsemane to discern what the Spirit is inviting him to do. His retreat director there, Matthew Kelty, who was also, by the way, Thomas Merton's confessor, will become John's confidant and a close friend. While there in Gethsemane, John remembers again the profound courage of the Polish slave laborer from the German prison camp. And the memory awakens in John a call to be a courageous and compassionate presence for the LGBT community, especially given the urgency of the AIDS crisis. And so John from Gethsemane writes to his superiors a number of letters where he says, God has called me to a ministry of compassion with gay people, and I cannot in conscience renounce that ministry. During the AIDS crisis, John goes with Father Michael Judge to the Catholic Worker. They present on one of the Friday night sessions, they reflect on the impact of AIDS on the poor and the homeless in the city. And eventually, John and Michael eventually helps establish the Upper Room AIDS Ministry, now Harlem United, and Michael Judge sets up his St. Francis AIDS Ministry. Actually, starting in 1976, after the publication of his book, John is invited by the directors of Kirkridge to come and lead for the first time a retreat for the LGBT community. And for 25 years, his retreats are packed each January and June. Virginia Mollenkott and Mary Hunt co-lead the June retreats with John and many others through the years. The retreats include a profound telling of coming out stories and what they call the fishbowl gathering on a Saturday night. There's reflections on the challenges of living more openly and more honestly. Lives are transformed. People find love, find healing, find liberation for the first time in their lives. Among those whose lives are changed and their hearts are transformed are Bishop Gene Robinson, who draws inspiration from his encounters and meetings with John at the retreats at Kirkridge. Here's one of the flyers from John's January retreats, Intimacy with God. A profound moment some years after was when I went with John to Rome in 2011. It was Euro Pride. John was welcomed and celebrated by LGBT Christian activists and leaders from all over Europe. John was chosen as the person to deliver a letter, well, mailed a letter actually, to Pope Benedict XVI, calling for dialogue, the urgency of dialogue in the Catholic Church, and for an end to anti-LGBT prejudice and violence. John also had a special message for LGBT youth. John called for the creation of communities of welcome and hospitality where friendship could flourish, and urged all to pray to the Holy Spirit for the grace of love and liberation and the courage to come out and live authentically. Having experienced that grace, John then advises all, each person, to reach out and become an instrument of liberation for others. Here's some images from that gathering in Rome. John was truly revered. Even at the Pride Parade in Rome, the cheers when John was wheeled along the avenue of that Pride Parade, people actually ran out with worn copies of John's book in Italian, asking him to sign the book, and people wanting to hug him and thank him for saving their lives. In fact, some even said, "You are our Pope. You are the pastor of our movement." In September 8, 2008, after 40 years, John returned to Toronto to legally marry his beloved Charlie. It was a profound moment to really witness the legal marriage of these two pioneers who had spent their lives affirming the love of same-sex couples and working for change of homophobic theology in the church and in society. Going back in 1987, after John was expelled from the Jesuits by order of Rome and the participation of the Jesuit leaders in Rome and in New York, John was chosen as Grand Marshal by the LGBT community in New York City to be the Grand Marshal of Pride 1987, the middle of the AIDS crisis. But also John was chosen to be honored for his courage and his outspokenness as a voice of liberation, not just in the church, but in society. In September 2015, it was September 19, I got a call from my friend Ken Page, who was in Florida at the hospital with John. And he said, "Brendan, now is the time come." And when I got to the hospital, there was a sign on the wall of room 407. And the sign said, "Is there something?" John was hospitalized, having been through hospice care. And these were his final hours. And the sign on the wall that said, "Is there something you want to share with us about yourself?" And John asked that it be written, "I am a Catholic priest." And then when it said, "Who is the family contact?" he said, "Charles Chiarelli, my husband." A few of us gathered with Charlie around John, giving thanks with and for him. He asked that I would whisper the memorare, that Catholic prayer. Every now and again, in between his breathing, John would whisper some words to us. "Thank you." He was so grateful for what the Holy Spirit was doing and for the movement of which he was part. John also would say, "God is love. If you know love, you know God." And then occasionally, once he raised his arms in the air and he just said, "Open the door, open the door." When I shared this with a friend of mine, Ed, he said, "Brendan, John opened the door of the closets for so many." And then on September 22nd, John died as Pope Francis was arriving in the United States.
This ground created as a place for people to find the spirit in their lives and go out to work for justice. This ground has welcomed the ashes of many brothers who have gone before.
Brothers and sisters on the mountain, there's often a custom that when we lay one of our brothers, we help to return the ashes to ashes and the dust to dust. And so you are invited at this time to come forward as you feel able and give the gift of soil back to John.
In 2011, it was great to begin to share the film, Taking a Chance on God, the documentary film on John McNeill. It was 10 years in the making. There's over 100 hours of interviews and stories. I simply wanted to unwrap the heart and life of John McNeill. It's been shared in many languages and continues to be screened around the world. I'm so grateful for the great, lovely film team, including Eileen Cutler, Dan Messina, and Peter Wetzler, who helped produce this film.
John McNeill made church history. John McNeill made church. He didn't read about churches, he didn't teach churches. John McNeill made church history.
John McNeill, along with a few others, were those early prophets who saw the truth and then had the courage to tell that truth and paid dearly for it.
I made the decision to enter the Jesuit order. And so I was ordained in 1959.
John had credibility in speaking out about against the war, especially as a Catholic priest who had been a veteran, very rare.
All along, I was intensely aware that I was a gay man. And, I had to, somewhere or other, deal with that.
God calls it an abomination. It's an abomination. It's an abomination!
Father John McNeill is a Jesuit teacher, a scholar, and a writer, and for the past 2 years, he has been dealing with the Roman Catholic Church on the subject of homosexuality.
I don't know if he even expected this, but it landed like a bomb.
He is Father John McNeill. Father McNeill wrote the book, The Church and the Homosexual.
I think it was the single most important event of the 20th century for gay liberation.
And that created a media explosion and a cultural explosion. Again, that's why the church ended up putting a lid on it.
It does not represent, in fact, it contradicts what the Catholic Church teaches.
So the provincial came to my office and read me a letter in Latin telling me that I was expelled from the Society of Jesus. It was a very painful moment.
John took Maurice Blondel's words to heart and would repeat it in so many retreats and places. Our God dwells within us. And the only way we can become one with our God is to become one with our authentic self. What a legacy. What insights from John's life. That theology is always and must be at the service of humanity. Our priority must be to form communities of hospitality where all are welcome, where friendships can flourish. Coming out is as important a social step as it is a response to a personal need. And action for social change and transformation is an important aspect of LGBTQ life. We have a responsibility to lift the burden of guilt and shame. LGBT love is a holy love. And for John, always that trust in the spirit within and among us. I just want to express my thanks. And now I'm moved and honored to hear from Mary Hunt, who will share with us.
Thank you, Brendan. I'm delighted to be with you for this presentation. More than that, I'm delighted that you and your partner, Tom, are on the mend from a serious car accident. We need you both in the struggles for justice. I want to begin by extending my thanks to LGBTQ RAN, especially to its visionary leader, Mark Bowman, and their IT genius, Ashati, for making this event possible. I want to offer special love and greetings to John's longtime partner, Charlie, who was mentioned many times in the last 45 minutes. I'm told he's with us today, and I know John would say it if he were here. Life was full of love and meaning with Charlie at his side. Welcome, Charlie. Your presence with us today is a deep blessing. I've been asked to offer simply the briefest of remarks in response to Brendan's tour de force through the life and work of John McNeill. I do so with great gratitude to Brendan for his dedicated and skillful curation of John's life and legacy. Your movie, Brendan, Taking a Chance on God, is a labor of love that guarantees as much as John's books that his legacy will endure. We are deeply in your debt. I will offer three short comments and be very glad to entertain questions in the session that follows. First, I reread John's work in preparation for today's session. It really stands the test of time. The Church and the Homosexual from 1976 changed the world. John made an airtight case for Catholic queer love, and in so doing, pushed the parameters of theological method to a robust embrace of the biological and social sciences. Without that methodological shift, which the Vatican has not embraced to this day on sex, though it has done so on other topics like climate change, it's brought in the biological sciences, for example, without that methodological shift, no changes in theoethics would have been possible. It was John who introduced that shift in our thinking about sexuality and Catholic theology. Like the subject of his doctoral dissertation, the work of the philosopher Maurice Blondel, John made human experience a critical component of theoethical reflection. Those many experiences were mediated by the best social scientific materials, in his case, especially psychology and anthropology. This allowed us to have an understanding of the human condition in all of its variety and complexity. And that was really John's goal, to see queer love along with many other kinds of love. What John wrote in that first book of his trilogy on homosexuality was only deepened over the long years of his practice as a psychotherapist. He worked with many gay men and a few lesbian women as they coped with loving, coming out, being rejected by their families and religious traditions. Many of those people emerged as strong, mature, out and proud queer people whose lives contributed to the world-shifting Catholic views that John captured in his writing. And John's own experience as a gay man in a loving relationship with Charlie made everything he wrote in The Church and the Homosexual take on new and brighter light. We are the heirs of that light, and those who follow us will rejoice in the sound of the name John McNeill. My second reflection is that I realized anew, rereading John, that what I had written about John also stands the test of time. Maybe it's because I'm from Syracuse and was in upstate New York during some of those years. But John quoted at length and with appreciation my National Catholic Reporter article of May 12, 1996 in his book, Both Feet Firmly Planted in Midair, his memoir written in 1998, in which I described, quote, the pivotal role he has carved out for himself in a changing church, unquote. I met John through Kirkridge events for LGBTQ Christians, which he and Virginia Ramey Mollenkott of blessed memory led prophetically for years. I had read his books before that, so I was honored to be invited with several other colleagues of my generation to join them in leadership. Now, John notes in the book that we did not always agree. On one occasion, we were asked to speak and respond to one another on the biblical passage, Romans 6:9. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. Some of you will remember that from your study of scripture. I, as a young theologian, had the temerity to propose, in good feminist fashion, and quoting the insights of the great feminist theologian Rosemary Radford Ruther, that death has all the dominion in the world. Just ask someone whose parent or child or lover or friend has died. Trust me, death has all the dominion in the world. I went on to say, with Ruther, that one way to think about it is that in death we become part of the great matrix of life. We are composted, as it were, into the cosmos as new life continues to emerge from old. John was completely and utterly horrified. He literally ran to the front of the conference room to deliver his response. Now, you might recall that at this point, he was not as young and fleet as he might have been in other moments, but he was racing to set the record straight. He addressed my error by announcing that when he died, he fully expected to run into the loving arms of his Abba Father, who would embrace him as little Jackie McNeill for all eternity. It was dramatic. I made clear that such a personal, even a private sense of eternal life and all of the earthly consequences of living out of such a worldview was something quite different from the feminist imagery that I was proposing. I allowed as to how it was far more common to men than to women to think that way. Individual mortality can be a matter of ego, I suggested, and it can reflect how we live our lives, our everyday lives. Women often with more of a sense of the whole. I also said, and on this we agreed, that we would eventually find out who was right. Maybe neither one of us was. But we both hoped that neither of us would find out anytime soon. People in the audience at Kirkridge still remember this exchange. It was shockingly frank and quite compelling. I hope they also realize that later that day, we all gathered around the table to share the Eucharist. Catholics all, John and I, good friends, and I hope John and I, good theologians, sharing our best insights, come what may. By the way, and certainly by way of afterward to this story, I must say that I laughed recently when I reread in Freedom, Glorious Freedom, the following statement. By John McNeill himself, I like to imagine God as dressed all in white, looking remarkably like John Travolta and inviting me to dance, while the Bee Gees in the background sing, ooh, 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 staying alive, staying alive. Now I see a little bit more of what little Jackie McNeill might really have had in mind. On another occasion, we had a spirited conversation on anonymous sex. As a lesbian feminist of a certain vintage, I admitted that I didn't know much about the ways of men's bars and baths. Instead, I thought rather primly that anonymous sex, especially given HIV/AIDS, was dubious, both from the point of view of health and safety and as a moral matter. John opened my eyes. He said forthrightly that for some people, anonymous sex, for that matter, any casual sexual encounters, may be the only intimate human contact some people ever have. He wrote the same thing about one-night stands. Given the human condition and the preponderance of loneliness, human contact counts for something, he said. I hadn't thought of it that way, but he had, in part because of his extensive pastoral ministry. I learned something that day. I came to agree with his insight and to see the narrowness of my own view. Since then, I have always appreciated, and yes, in fact, I have always championed the variety of ways in which people choose to express their sexuality. To quote a noted source, who am I to judge? Well, I hope I'm a sex-affirming Catholic and can make some sense of the many life choices, even those that I might not make for myself. I do that thanks to John McNeill. Finally, I can say that it's not too early to say, and to say again, that John McNeill has already been vindicated by history, and much more praise is due to him. I stand by my 1996 prediction from the same article when I wrote, quote, he will be labeled the contemporary equivalent of a doctor of the church. With the recent death of his nemesis, Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger, also known as Pope Benedict XVI, a chapter in church history has closed, like the triple casket in which that Pope Emeritus was buried, Cyprus, zinc, and oak, to protect him, God knows why. We now see that the worldview that led institutional church officials to call for John's silencing and led the Jesuits down the primrose path to carrying out their bidding can no longer be sustained. The truth about love that John McNeill wrote, spoke about, indeed lived, is simply a given now. Love comes in many forms. Love takes its place in the world in embodied ways, and love is of God. Let me say that again. The truth about love that John McNeill wrote about, spoke about, and lived is simply this, that love comes in many forms, love takes its place in the world in embodied ways, and love is of God. Putting that toothpaste back into the tube is not going to happen. That is now normative Catholic thinking in many and increasingly more parts of the world. One simple reason for that is because many people took John McNeill seriously. We named and claimed our own queer lives and succeeded, despite backlash that continues until today, to make a variety of ways of being human and of loving normative. Moreover, because such insights are based on religious and spiritual values, they are not private, but public. They are not personal, but political. Not solitary, but communal. Not fleeing, but rooted in tradition. That, in fact, is the legacy of John McNeill. And one way we can understand that is to see the ways in which John was taken seriously in so many places around the world. Many groups have emerged from John's and other people's insights in organizing. Chief among them have been Dignity, New Ways Ministry, the Conference of Catholic Lesbians from 1980 to 2019, and now the global network of Rainbow Catholics, with more groups to follow. LGBTIQ people and those who actively support them are increasingly acknowledged and reverenced. The power of the Roman Catholic institutional church to persist in its grievous error on love is diminishing apace, but not fast enough, and yet with more speed than many realize. So a safer, more welcoming world is emerging for those who seek to be faithful after us. For that, I bow to and I thank John McNeill. Thank you. And now I turn to Mark Bowman to take up the question and answer session. Again, my gratitude.
What? Oh, thank you. Thank you so much, Brendan and Mary, for that inspiring, moving presentation. I think we have a special treat here. Mary has mentioned that Charles Chiarelli is here. I think Charlie has agreed to come on screen. I have not had the chance to meet Charlie. Brendan and Mary know him, and you might want to hear a word from Charlie, or Brendan and Mary may have a question to bring in to Charlie. In the meantime, if anyone else has a question or a comment they'd like to direct to Mary or Brendan, please put those in the Q&A or in the chat. John, while this is happening, Brendan, there's a couple of questions here from John D'Amelio. How does one get to see Taking a Chance on God, the documentary, and then have John's papers been archived? If so, where? I can answer the latter. The John's papers are at the Center for the CLGS, Center for LGBTQ Gender Studies and Religion at the Pacific School of Religion in Berkeley, California. I can't remember the state of their being processed, but that's where the papers are. And so, Brendan, getting access to the documentary?
For getting access to the documentary is available. Anybody can get on and rent it for viewing for $4.99, or you can actually purchase the film for $20 as well. So that's on Taking a Chance on God, or it's, if you just type in Taking a Chance on God on Vimeo, it will come up. Yeah, but it's available. If anybody needs to, they can also reach me, and I'll be very happy to sort that out and make that available to them. And anybody in other languages that want it, I'd be happy to make it available for them as well.
Charlie, we didn't prepare this or rehearse this, but you would be welcome to unmute if you would like to share a few reflections or your thoughts on what you've heard from Brendan and Mary, Charlie.
Good evening, everybody. I'm obviously overwhelmed by all the wonderful things that are being said and described over the years of the endeavors that had to be done over with the help of so many people. And anyway, I'm just very glad. Thank you, Brendan. Thank you, Mary, for your eloquence in tonight's presentation. And thank you, Mark, for setting it up in the first place with all your assistance, I imagine. I really don't know what else to say except thank you all for taking the time for this.
Yes, and clearly we have a deep expression of appreciation and gratitude to you, Charlie, for the support and that you provided to John for decades, and the way that you enabled and empowered him to be the person and the witness that he was. That was a great treat. So at this point, actually, I don't see other questions. And so I will just remind folks that you will get an email within a few days with the recording of tonight's presentation. You could share that with family and friends. If you would like to have any comments or greetings to Charlie, Brendan, or Mary, simply stay on here after we end, and you'll be invited into the Zoom room with them. So again, thank you so much for the presentation tonight. If you are interested in more opportunities to explore the history of queer religious movements, check out the LGBTQ website, and particularly our events page. There will you find announcements of future online programs, as well as recording of past presentations. Our next webinar will be 2 weeks from tonight, entitled Preserving Sistery, Archives and the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence, moderated by Melissa Wilcox, PhD. This presentation will look at queer religious life from some unusual perspectives. In closing, I remind you that LGBTQRN is the first and foremost source of information on LGBTQ+ religious history. We are a very small operation that is funded through the generosity of friends like you. So if you would like to see more programs like this one, and if you share our commitment to ensure that future generations will hear our voices and stories, please help make this happen with your gift. Finally, once again, I remind you that if you would like to offer personal greetings to Mary or Brendan or Charlie, just stay here and you will be invited to the room with them. I close with much gratitude for the well-lived life of John McNeill and for our presenters. Good night to all.